Back in Newark, New Jersey, the 2013 NHL Draft, and the 15th pick belongs to the New York Islanders. Last year, the Islanders had 7 picks in the draft and used every single one of them on defensemen. This year made the playoffs for the first time in 6 years and gave the Pittsburgh Penguins a run in the opening round, taking them to a tough 6 games. So Garth Snow and the Islanders will make their way up. There's only been one trade involving a first-round pick so far in this draft. That was the Canucks and the New Jersey Devils, as the Canucks jumped into the 9th spot in exchange for Corey Schneider. Earlier today, we saw Tyler Kennedy go from Pittsburgh to the 50th overall pick to San Jose. So thus far, the movement hasn't been quite what we thought it might be in terms of...
And Nino Niederreiter, the Islanders had moved Niederreiter earlier for Cal Clutterbuck.
But in terms of actual first-round picks getting dealt, there's been but one in today. Islanders were criticized for several years for rushing their prospects, and that might have been the case with Nino Niederreiter. In recent years, they've been a lot more patient.
Smart sending Griffin Reinhart back. Real smart.
And here's Garth Snow with the pick.
I'd like to take this opportunity to say hello to the 5,000 fans that we have at the Nassau Coliseum for our draft party. The New York Islanders select Ryan Pulock from the Brandon Wheat Kings.
Ryan Pulock from the Brandon Wheat Kings, the hardest shooting defenseman available in this entire draft. Played 3 full seasons with the Brandon Wheat Kings, a late 94 birth date, and he's got an absolute bomb for a shot that's been clocked at more than 100 miles per hour.
That's 8 straight defensemen for the Islanders that they've drafted.
And they love the West.
Well, Griffin Reinhart out of the West, and obviously Ryan Pulock out of the West, played for Brandon and Kelly McCrimmon. I think the biggest thing Bob just talked about, Ray, is how hard he can shoot it. They lost Mark Streit, who's moved on to the Philadelphia Flyers. They clearly need to have an offensive presence for the power play. He can help it.
He's not a risky player. Dependability is really his calling card. But he, as you guys mentioned, he's got a shot that everybody talks about. And he too, like, you get into this stage of the draft, you're talking about guys that need a little bit of time to mature. And with the depth that the Islanders have started to accumulate on the blue line, Pulock's going to have that.
He only missed 6-8 games with injury over the course of the year, but he was playing injured for much of the year. He had a bad wrist. He had some other injuries that were a problem. And scouts felt they were having a tough time getting a read on him because they knew that he was nowhere close to 100%. But this is a young man who's experienced great tragedy in his life. And when he was 15 years old, before he went to Brandon, his family, he was in a car, and he was in the vehicle with his family. And his 13-year-old brother, Brock, was killed in that tragedy. And the tattoo that Ryan has on his chest is a maple leaf tattoo with the number 4 and the name Brock. The reason for the maple leaf tattoo is because Brock's favorite team was the Toronto Maple Leafs. So I'm sure for his entire family, it's obviously an emotional time to see Ryan Pulock play those 3 years in Brandon and go to Brandon with such a heavy heart. And the terrible irony of it is that Kelly McCrimmon, the general manager of the Brandon Wheat Kings, welcomes Ryan Pulock into the organization, knowing that the family and Ryan have gone through an enormous tragedy. And not long after that, Kelly McCrimmon also lost his brother, Brad.
Well, Ryan Pulock from Brandon. They got another hard-shooting defenseman from Brandon by way of Moose Jaw, Travis Hamonic. So that's going to fit in nicely for the Islanders long-term, a little bit of familiarity.
They're going to switch to a 2-3 formation and dress 3 defensemen at a time, play 3 defensemen at a time.
As a 16-year-old, Ryan Pulock beat Wade Redden's franchise record in Brandon for points.
Now, there are still tremors being felt on the draft floor after that Vancouver, New Jersey trade. Here's Darren Dreger with more.
All right, Gord, thank you very much. It's possible but hard to believe that there could be a bigger storyline than the one that Vancouver has created again in the trade, sending Corey Schneider to the New Jersey Devils for 9th pick overall. Mike Gillis has yet to speak with Roberto Luongo. Some believe that Roberto Luongo is not going to be happy with this development. He was hoping to cut bait entirely and, you know, embrace a brand new change in a new city with a new organization. Gillis telling me a few minutes ago that he intends to reach out to Roberto Luongo a little bit later today. He said, I just need to let things settle down a bit. And it's presumed that John Tortorella will also speak to Roberto Luongo at some point today, guys.
All right, so that is the headline thus far in this draft is that the Vancouver Canucks deal Corey Schneider, not Roberto Luongo, and get the ninth overall pick in this draft. There's going to be a lot of discussion about that and the long-term implications for both teams, but also the short-term implications, not just for Roberto Luongo, but what about Martin Brodeur?
And this is, we'll talk about Brodeur in a second. This is John Tortorella's first real test as a coach of the Vancouver Canucks. How's he going to smooth the waters with Roberto Luongo? Ray, you live out in that community. You know this is not going to be an easy thing to fix.
Didn't matter what happened in the game the previous night. It was who's starting goal the next day. How did he play? Okay, Schneider played well. Is Luongo going to play the next night? Well, those questions are gone. They have some younger goaltenders, in particular a young guy who had hip surgery last year in Eddie Lack, who will probably be considered as the backup goaltender to Luongo. But for basically a year, everything has been that Luongo is on the way out. We've made our decision. Remember when they signed Corey Schneider? They anointed him as the number one goaltender. He'll be our number one goaltender. We'll deal with Roberto Luongo and move him along. Now, Roberto Luongo's their guy again. And you can't underestimate how difficult that will be mentally for Luongo to get his head around, but he's a championship caliber goaltender who's now gonna have to carry the ball again. It's his team again.
And now to the Martin Brodeur part of this story. Marty Brodeur knew for a long time and has known for a long time. He had last year and this coming season, and then it was probably over for him. Lou Lamoriello had to do something internally outside of Scott Wedgwood. They don't have a lot going forward. They needed to do something. Chris Terreri is the goalie coach here in New Jersey now. He will do an outstanding job helping Corey Schneider get to the level that Lou Lamoriello and the Devils fans will need him to be.
All right, now time for the Buffalo Sabres. Their second pick in this opening round. This is the pick they got for the Minnesota Wild in the Jason Pominville trade. It's one of four picks they have in the top 52. They pick Rasmus Ristolainen, the defenseman from Finland, with the eighth overall pick.
Well, if they want goals, they certainly got Hunter Shinkarak or Anthony Mantha there. If they want defense and potential offense from the blue line, Nikita Zadorov from London.
Buffalo Sabres select from the London Ice and Ontario Hockey League, Nikita Zadorov.
Well done, Bob.
Well, you've done this before?
a big, physical, mean, one of the scouts I surveyed, hardest hitting defensemen available in this draft, Nikita Zadorov. He's gigantic and first year with the London Knights. And again, to get crazy with the hyperbole, you talk to Mark Hunter, Mark Hunter says, listen, I know he's not this player, but he can have the same impact on junior hockey games for the London Knights the way Larry Robinson did in the National Hockey League. Now, ability to do that at the next level, we'll see, but think of that kind of player.
Well, there you get a little taste of how physical it can be at the point of attack. Big body, as you talk about, Bob. I think there's a little underappreciated offense in his game, too, Ray. He's a little bit better offensively than people give him credit for.
You know, if I'm an NHL GM, I want defensemen from the London Knights. I mean, for the last 10 years, since the Hunters took over there, it has been an absolute assembly line of NHL-caliber defensemen.
He doesn't run for hits, but he makes them. We saw in the video there. I was told by a scout one of the most impressive things about Nikita Zadorov is the way that he was able to learn the English language in about 8 months. That at the beginning of the year, he was just a kid of few words. At the end, they couldn't shut him up in the interviews. And that, to me, is a kid that is ready to take on a challenge of becoming a top-end defenseman, not a guy that works his way into the league and hangs on by his fingernails. Zadorov has got some growth here, like some hockey playing growth to make, but the thought is that there is growth there.
He made an immediate impact coming into the Ontario Hockey League. Here's a big Russian kid, as you said, got language barriers, comes in with the London Knights, and in the first 2 weeks of the season, he's dropped the gloves with a couple of Ontario Hockey League heavyweights, which maybe wasn't advisable, and came up with some unbelievable big hits. And then there was game five in the playoffs against London, when he absolutely buried Tom Wilson with a big hit and then dropped the gloves and fought with Mitchell Hurd.
All right, when we come back, the Ottawa Senators are next up, and still to come, the Toronto Maple Leafs as well. There's lots of intrigue on the draft floor. We'll have more of it when we come back.